sahanau bhunaktu saha viryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shanti. Samasta jana kalyane niratam karunamayam namami chinmayam devam satgurum brahmavidvaram.
So I won't, as we are starting a bit late, so I won't take up much of your time. I'll just call Arvind to introduce Swamiji, and then we'll move on to the talk. And at the end of the talk, we'll talk a few brief words.
Hari Om. Swamiji actually doesn't need much introduction at all. But it's for our, it's our privilege to introduce Swamiji, and also it's like an inspiration for all of us to recount all the different roles that Swamiji is playing to perfection. So only from that perspective that I'm trying to introduce this introduction here. Swamiji is a, as the Acharya in charge of Chinmaya Mission Mumbai as well as Chinmaya Mission South Mumbai. And he heads all the programs that have, that are done all through the year in both these parts of the Chinmaya Mission. Other than that, Swamiji has an excellent connect with the youth, which everyone of you knows. Swamiji is also the national director of the All India Chinmaya Yuva Kendra, AIC. And Swamiji is also heading the Youth Empowerment Program, or YEP, which is a one-year program where youngsters get trained to dedicate 1 year of their lives in service of the national cause. Swamiji is also heading the Youth Empowerment Program, as many of you may be already aware. Apart from that, Swamiji is also a very sought-after speaker in the corporate circles. Swamiji having done sessions with the Piramals, Birla, Reliance, Mahindra, Tata Motors, and many other places. Swamiji establishes a very good connect on even the most complex of topics with his trademark equations, which I'm sure we will all also get to learn and enjoy as we go along in this session. And this Chinmaya Pradeep, where we are standing today, is something that Swamiji has been behind right from the start, from the conceptualization, design, to the execution. I mean, every stone and every plant here has happened with Swamiji's vision and to dedicate it to Pujya Gurudev. And it's a great honor for all of us to be here among and today and with the camp on Pradeep by Swamiji. So that's a great honor for all of us to be a part of. Swamiji is also a playwright, and he has written and directed several plays like Adrishya and Just Like That, which I'm sure all of you have seen, and if not, there's one more chance coming very soon. So with that short introduction, let's start the camp. Thank you, Swamiji, for being with us. Hari Om.
Hari Om. Thank you, Nivedita and Arvind. We'll start with one more invocation. Om Shri Tapovana Paramagurave Namaha. Om Shri Chinmaya Sadgurave Namaha. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Om Samasta Jana Kalyane Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Satgurum Brahmavidvaram. Hari Om, salutations to all, and welcome to this camp, Chinmaya Pradeep, at Chinmaya Pradeep. So the purpose of this camp is to understand the vision of Chinmaya Pradeep and how it impacts us in our lives. This whole composition, whole Pradeep is based on a composition called Kritagnataa. So we will be following this text, Kritagnataa, which is there in your book, Guru Mahima. Page number 24. So Kritagnataa literally means gratitude. When we live in our life and we introspect, we observe, while we go through the whole life, the different experiences, one important aspect is to be aware of those experiences and what they do to us as we go through it. Gurudev is to define a seeker. That who is a seeker? The moment one examines the validity of one's pursuits, one becomes a seeker. What am I doing? Why am I doing? What did I get out of it? Basic questions. But the attitude of a seeker is to constantly be aware of various experiences, to go through life consciously. Not that somehow life happens. Somebody said very nicely that life is what happens to us when we are busy making other plans. One should not be like that. Each and every experience we go through it consciously. That is the attitude of a seeker. So the person who examines life properly, when we go through our life, we understand that in spite of whatever we achieve in life, there is a certain emptiness, there is a certain incompleteness. And whatever we do in life, sometimes is an escape from that incompleteness. Many times we feel very uncomfortable when there is even that feeling of incompleteness. When we face our own mind, when we face our own sense of limitation as a jiva, I am so limited, so bound. So to escape from that feeling comes to people in different ways. It need not come in the way in which I am talking just now, in those words exactly. But it can come in the sense of there is something more to life, I don't know what it is. I am not so satisfied with what is happening right now. In spite of achieving everything, there is something which is missing. In different ways one feels that. So, the seeker is one who will face this. The sense of incompleteness, the sense of emptiness. And this quest in each one of us is to seek that completeness and fulfillment, without which the life feels very empty. So a person who has observed life very carefully will have this quest for the higher. One may choose to call it spiritual quest, quest for God, you know, whichever formal name one wants to give, that is a different thing. But the quest is there in everybody. Some people are aware of it, some people are not aware of it. Those who are aware of it and they are seeking consciously the solution for that incompleteness, they are the seekers. Others are also seekers, but at the moment the bhav of seeker is tormented. So, someone who has become aware intensely, the Upanishads say, Pariksha Lokan Karmachitan Brahmanaha, having seen this world very, very closely. Brahmana here doesn't mean somebody who is born as a Brahman. Brahmana here literally means somebody who is a reflective person, who is thinking, what is the purpose of life, why am I born, what is to be done, what are we achieving here. In Hindi there is a very nice line which says that, Moti lene aya jag mein seep se dil behlaye. Now we came to take pearls. And what are we making ourselves happy with? The seashells. We came here for permanent happiness and fulfillment. And what are we making ourselves satisfied with? Temporary happiness. Pizza mil jaye, ah, maja. So nice. Some money I get, oh. Some power, some position, some award, wow. Nothing wrong in feeling happy about it, but is that what I came for? That person teacher should not be forgotten. So a seeker goes to a teacher with this quest, that what is that knowing which I will become fulfilled. Sometimes the seeker is not even aware of the sorrows or the limitation. Going to the teacher, one even becomes aware of that. Teacher's job also is to make the person turn within and understand what is the life that one is leading right now. People like Gurudev had that quest and they went to the teacher. So, when a person goes to a teacher, seeking that knowledge, the feeling in the mind of that person is, I have seen in this world, Pariksha Lokan, Karma Chitan, this world of action, this world of finite world, I have seen power, position, name, fame, everything. One has gone through it. Nirveda Mayat. The person has become dispassionate towards it because one has understood that what I truly demand is that cannot be got from this. So just like we have Vairagya towards teddy bear. Does anybody feel fascinated? The moment you see a teddy bear, does it tempt? Does it make us feel that, you know, I must have it. At any cost I must have it. No, because one has grown out of it. Nirveda Maya. Does one have any revulsion? Maine teddy bear mere samne mat lao. Nikal do isko. It doesn't even matter. It is there, it is not there. How does it even matter? My attention only is not on that. That is the mindset of the seeker who has gone to the teacher. Nirveda Maya. Na asti akrita kritena. There is nothing in this world which can produce permanent happiness. Akritaha is permanent happiness. Kritena is by action. No matter how much action I do, I will still remain finite only. So my problem is not that I have less money or less recognition or less fame or less love or less happiness. That is not the problem. Because even if I get these, and there are many who have got these, the sense of jiva, the sense of limitation, Mr. So-and-so, the ego, and insecurities, attachments that come with it, those are not going. That's why in the corporate world they have a very nice saying. No matter what you do, in the world of rat race, even if you win, you are still a rat, hiding below a mat, afraid of the cat. How much ever we achieve, one has to come to that feeling. In Vivek Chudamani, this seeker is there who has gone to the teacher like that. He says, Durvara Samsara Davagni Taptam. I am getting scorched in this fire of samsara. Do we feel? Swamiji, today little bit heat is there. We are not talking about this heat. Samsara Agni, you know, getting scorched in the fire of samsara. And what is that? It is not outside. Don't say yes, Swamiji. Before marriage I was happy. After marriage I am getting scorched. One PJ I read somewhere. One man said, before marriage I was not a believer. Marriage turned me into a believer. So that man said, believer of what? He said, believer of hell. So samsara agni is what? The constant thirst for permanent happiness in the temporary things and the sense of incompleteness, dissatisfaction because of that. That is samsara agni. My ego, my false identification, that is samsara. It's not outside at all. People, position, power, anything out there, that is not the source of bondage. The source of bondage is my own ignorance and my attachments. One who has faced that, saying this jiva bhav is the cause of sorrow. Samsara, durvara samsara davagni taptam. It's like a forest fire. Dodhuyamanam duradrishta vatahi. I am pushed, you know, in strong winds, one just gets blown here and there. Duradrishta vatahi. Strong winds are there in this world. Which are these strong winds? The force of my own desires. if a desire arises in the mind, not to fulfill that, my God, so tough to let go of that desire. The desire comes with such impulse. That's why he says, in the Gita, Bhagavan says very nicely that who will be happy? Shaknoti hai vaya sodhum prak sharira vimokshanat kama krodhod bhavam vegam sayukta sasukhi nara. Vegam, the vega, the power with which kama and krodha arise, that impulse we are not able to control. Do we feel that bondage, that, you know, I am a victim of my own desires and my anger? Anger here means all the emotions arising out of attachment. And is there a desire to, is there a need to come out of that state? So the student says that I am scorching in the fire of samsara. I am getting carried away by this force of desire, which are strong winds. Bhitam prapannam. I am extremely scared. Are we not living in fear every moment? What fear is there? So many different types of fear. Fear of losing something. Fear of ridicule. Fear of failure. Fear of what people will say. How many types of fear? Fear of death. Fear of public speaking. Don't worry, we will get that one fear out of you today. You will have to come and speak. Fear. We live in so much of fear, moment by moment, holding on to something. What I have got, I am scared of losing. What I don't have, I am scared whether it will come to me, not come to me, it will come to go to somebody else. Bhitam. So I am scared, I have impulse, anger, desire, sense of limitation. With all these, and the biggest fear is fear of change and death. Mrityu. So he says, Bhitam prapannam paripahi mrityo. Sharanya manya yadaham na jane. I don't know any other refuge. I come to you, O teacher. Every seeker goes through this phase. If I go through this phase, I am a seeker. If I am very comfortable in samsara, the seeker in me has not woken up yet. I am not saying we have to be so disturbed all the time. But the point is, do I face this, and at those times do I invoke that seeker in me that I must overcome this? So a student has gone to a teacher with that feeling that there is emptiness in this life. I don't know any other refuge, you please teach. Because in the world outside I have seen everything, now there is nothing more to see. Now what is left is inside, and I don't know how to turn within. So you please teach me, train me. So the person goes to that teacher. And the knowledge that the guru gives, that you are not this body, mind and intellect. You are that supreme consciousness. You are in fact what you seek. That permanent happiness that we seek is our true nature already. And how to turn that mind systematically, how to live in discipline, how to bring the BMI together and to transcend it. All that knowledge the teacher gives, and the student realizes the truth. When the student realizes the truth, the feeling that is there in the mind of that student, that feeling is called gratitude. Kritagnataa. Why? Because lives after lives I have gone through this quest for permanent happiness, going through the sense of incompleteness, not being aware of my nature as happiness, and getting tossed about in this samsara. How many bodies I have taken? If we just imagine the sorrow, in the Gita Bhagavan says these are cause of sorrow only in samsara. Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadhi. These four. Dukkha and Dosha. We have to see the pain of this and the limitation of this. Of these four. Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadhi. Just imagine what a pain it is, not to be born. Imagine one more birth. And that also, suppose human birth is not there, then you may become one banyan tree in Pradeep and stand like that. For years together, understanding. Any lower form one becomes, any higher form one becomes, human body is not easy to get, even if we get human body. Where will we get satsang? Where will we get realized master? So difficult. And will that human mind have that ability, that moment to seek the truth? It may get distracted by so many other temptations. Birth is a pain if we actually go to see. Gurudev defines, explains that. 9 months get roasted in the womb. As if we are not getting roasted enough in samsara and in the womb. For entertainment, people have roasts nowadays. They roast each other. The mind is carried away like that. So if I imagine, janma is dukkha. So much of pain to be born. 9 months in the womb. No electricity is there. No AC is there. Space problem is there. And I am hanging upside down, surrounded by fecal matter. Jatharagni is all around. Again, Swamiji, 84 lakh times you have already gone through it. Now we are used to it. 84 lakh species we have gone through it, all of us. How many births? We don't know. Births are many more. So a student who has analyzed all that goes to the teacher, and when he gets the knowledge, he feels so grateful, ki, thank God, free. How sometimes we feel, no? Friday evening everybody waits for. Weekend, free. And what is the feeling on Monday morning? Blue, Monday morning blue. Again I have to go for work. That feeling, no? Again I have to go for work. Multiplied 10,000 times, that is the feeling of a seeker, again I have to be born. Just imagine that. So that teacher, seeker who has gone to the teacher, gaining to get the knowledge, feels so fulfilled and feels grateful. I have attained that, having gained which nothing more remains to be gained. After that, even if birth has to happen, there is no problem. So, you know, really speaking, birth and death is not a problem. Ignorance of my true nature is a problem. I don't know who am I, so then I am suffering in the world. This student who has felt that, that is gratitude. So, gratitude is an expression of fulfillment. One aspect of gratitude is that. But gratitude also is a sadhana which will help us to go to fulfillment. Meaning, a person who feels grateful will not have insatiable desires, will feel contented and happy with the externalities at least. So the person is ready to turn within. The mind which does not have contentment and gratitude is always craving for things outside and always cribbing and complaining. This is not proper, that is not proper, this should have been like that, that should have been like that. That's why nowadays they tell us, no? Be grateful, don't complain. Whatever is happening for the good. Those things which are said, they are meant for that. Otherwise the mind is very capable to find flaws, to criticize, to complain. Even in the best of the circumstances, it will know how to complain. There's one factory going on here, complaint factory. Constantly it creates complaints. So the mind always feels something is not there. This is not that emptiness, this is the feeling of discontentment, frustration. Gratitude is to count the blessings. So what happens in gratitude? I start observing what I already have, rather than chasing what I don't have. Not that gratitude will not make me achieve anything great in life, but it will not be out of insecurity. People who are grateful, they also achieve, but not out of insecurity. They don't crib and complain. And this sadhana of being, of counting the blessings of whatever I have is so much already, that helps me to also turn within and observe the self which I am already. So gratitude as a sadhana will help me to live a more happy life, live a more contented life, live a more creative life also. Because when my mind is filled with gratitude, it is sattvic emotion. Creativity, innovation, out of the box thinking, all that will happen in a mind which is like that. It will help me to value what I have. That is gratitude sadhana. This human body, am I really grateful for this human body? Even devatas do not get human body. People who have done punya karma and go to heaven, they also don't get a human body. Very rare is this human body. So many blessings we have now. A healthy human body is a blessing. A mind which is able to feel positively is a blessing. People are there to love us is a blessing. We are able to think properly is a blessing. Perceive properly is a blessing. There are so many people who are specially challenged. For them, basic things are difficult. So we take a lot of things for granted. That is how we have taken ourselves also for granted. And how strange it is. No, we are very worried about nobody should take me for granted. But I have taken myself for granted for years together. And who am I don't know. So this sadhana of gratitude is a very powerful sadhana. It helps me to value what I have. Cherish what I have. People who are in my life, do I value them? Do I feel grateful for them? Typically we have seen, what happens? When the person is alive, one goes on fighting with that person. And when the person passes away, what a noble man this person was. This person did this person did that, and in this experience, this is how this person behaved. When he was there or she was there, that time I should have done, no? So gratitude for people, gratitude for things that I have, for the healthy body I have, for the resources that I have. All that when I feel, I value what I have. When I value what I have, will I not do the best of that? Will I not make the best use of that? If I don't value what I have, then I'll use it somehow. So if I value this human life, if I value time, ask somebody who is on the deathbed, ask them the value of time. They will not be able to extend even one moment, and they will say that, value your time. So many people who say value your time, we hear also, value the time, but we take it for granted. We think about it, most precious resource is time. Breath goes, whether we like it or not. Our life is counted by our number of breaths. Our age is counted by the number of breaths. And time just takes it away like this. Kalo jagat bhakshaka, it is said. Time is the one who eats away this whole world. So it's a very precious resource. Do I value that? So kritagnata as an expression of fulfillment is one aspect, where the student has realized the truth and then is expressing the fulfillment to the teacher. In the Gita, that line for that is, evam buddhva buddhiman syat krita krityascha bharata. That person is called as buddhiman, who has done what needs to be done. Meaning who has put the efforts to realize the self and become one with it. So there is nothing more to be done. Krita kritya. Whatever had to be done, the person has done. So that feeling of oneness, that feeling of fulfillment is gratitude. That is one part of gratitude. To come to that, the second part of gratitude is to count my blessings, to live in the state of gratitude. Just imagine, even if right now we are sitting here, is Is it not a blessing? So many of us are here. In a whole city of Mumbai, crores of people who are there, thousands of mission members who are there. 30, 40 of you are sitting here right now. And we are listening to Kritagnataa Stotram, and we are going to listen to Gurudev's vision, his life, his journey. Such a blessing to be. So the person who experience, who lives in this state, Kritagnataa, is a person who is a seeker. A seeker will be, in the Gita, Bhagavan says, santushto yena kena chit. Whatever comes one's way externally, one is happy with that because my attention is not on the outside. Attention is on the inside, knowing the self. So this composition of Guruji is based on Kritagnataa, gratitude towards the Guru, and also gratitude that we can practice as a sadhana. We should remember one thing very important. The Guru-Shishya Sambandha does not happen by our karma. The Guru-Shishya Sambandha happens by the karuna of the, kripa of the Lord and karuna of the Satguru. Our karma is a small part. That punya karma we do, it brings satsang. Otherwise it happens only by kripa of Bhagavan, blessing of the Lord and compassion of the teacher. Imagine compassion of Gurudev, that he came down. Even when his own teacher has said, don't go down, people who want the knowledge will come up to you. You will get caught in the cycle of samsara. The karma chakra, you will get caught in karma chakra. But for us, he was willing to do that. That is compassion. So he came down. So this sambandha is out of gratitude, out of this kripa and karuna. Hence the disciple has gratitude that yes, it's the grace of the Lord, blessings of the Lord, compassion of the Sadguru that a teacher is even found by us. So in this composition, we find that Guruji has expressed the gratitude towards Puja Gurudev. Last two verses specifically express the gratitude, so we will see. Beginning, he explains the whole life of Gurudev, his vision and his work. And hence feels grateful that we found such a great master in our lives, because of whom there is a direction. So, there are 11 verses here, and we will see this text. So, take the first verse is what we generally chant. We just chant, we opened the session also, the inaugural session with this. Samasta jana kalyane niratam karunamayam namami chinmayam devam satgurum brahmavidvaram. So here is, there are five aspects of Gurudev in this. Samasta jana kalyane niratam is the visionary and a missionary aspect of Gurudev, which is what you see here. Samasta jana kalyane niratam. Person who had a great vision and who is ever striving to bring that vision to serve the masses in a spirit of a missionary. Missionary means who? One who is fired by a vision and who all his activities or her activities are tuned towards that. Don't misunderstand the word missionary as somebody who is out to convert. That is a very limited meaning of the word. One who is on a mission, who is very focused, who wants to implement a particular vision, which is a higher vision, selfless vision. That person is a missionary. There is no selfish interest involved in that. So first aspect is Gurudev as a visionary and a missionary. Samasta jana kalyane niratam. Second is Gurudev as a sannyasi. Karunamayam. So karuna is the quality of a sannyasi. In Srimad Bhagavatam it is said, titikshavaha karunikascha. Karunikascha. The quality of a sannyasi is one who is tolerant towards the inner weaknesses. One bears them and strives to overcome them, but doesn't judge oneself, brand oneself, condemn oneself. Titikshavaha. Karunikascha. And one who is compassionate towards the people around. Accommodates them, takes them along. So that is Gurudev as a sannyasi. Samasta jana kalyane niratam karunamayam. Namami Chinmayam Devam. My salutations to Swami Chinmayananda, who was a unique person. He has his own special attributes. His oratorical skills, his letter writing, his, you know, humor and wit, style, so many things. Punctuality, discipline, leadership. Lots of these qualities that Gurudev had. Very unique to him. Namami Chinmayam Devam. Satgurum, one who is a teacher. A teacher who brought the highest people. Guru literally means a teacher. One who removes ignorance. Darkness of ignorance. But Satguru means one who removes the darkness of ignorance of the truth. Every other teacher can make us only better finite. So if I am poor, I will become rich. If I don't have good values, I become better human being. If I am not very cultured, I become very cultured. Finite becomes a better finite. Sadguru destroys our finitude and makes us aware of our infinite nature. That is Sadguru. Satgurum Brahmavidvaram. Gurudev is as a realized master. One who experienced supreme state of consciousness and gaining which nothing is to be gained. These are five aspects and whole Chinmaya Pradeep is based on these five aspects. So one may see, okay, these are five aspects of Gurudev's life. So what do I do with that? All these five aspects are connected to our own life also. How are they connected to our life? So these are five questions. And what you have to do is, you have to pin these five questions to these five aspects. Those five questions are written there. Pradeep begins with that. When people enter, they read those five questions. So I will tell you those five questions. These are questions for us to introspect also. And the exercise that you will do right now is just match the following. You match this question matches which part, okay? So the first question there is, what is that gaining which one's life is fulfilled? Which aspect does this match?
Realized master.
Realized master. Okay, very good. Then, what is the importance of a higher vision and how to commit to it? That is visionary and missionary. What is the best way to serve? Teacher. Okay. What is Vedanta and its importance in my life? So these two questions, what is the best way to serve and what is the importance of Vedanta in my life? What is Vedanta and its importance in my life? What can be teacher or a sannyasi? What? Which question will apply to which one? Vedanta applies to this one. What is Vedanta and its importance in my life is for teacher. What is the best way to serve? Sannyasi. Is sannyasi. Why? Because sannyasi serves most selflessly, wanting nothing for oneself. That the only duty of a sannyasi is contemplate on the self. And when the mind is not able to stay in that state, because it's not easy to stay in that state all the time. So, and the best way to serve is selflessness. Nothing one wants for oneself. Just imagine the entire Chinmaya mission Gurudev built. What did he get? Did he even ask that question? What did I get? What will you give me? Even if sometimes he does something, it will not be because he wants it. It will be because the mission requires it, and mission is meant to serve the people. It is not for himself. So sometimes, you know, if you go to him with a photograph to get an autograph, so he will say, give 100 rupees. Then only I will sign. People will say, kitna commercial Swami hai. People used to say, but what, it is going in his pocket. You don't know the importance of his time. He has left his samadhi and come. He is asking you 100 rupees for the work for you. To build one mission, to build one school, to build one orphanage, to do something. And for that he is asking money. He is not asking for his bank account or anything. And why does he have to ask like that? Because projects are many. Contribution is less. And he is a sannyasi who goes with a begging bowl. Please give. Oh, what a compassion he had, my God. When he started Sandipani in one place, one occasion, he said, in the earlier days, in the Gurukul system, the Guru will be in the ashram and the disciple goes out, asks bhiksha, bring it, everybody pulls it together, shares and eats. In modern setting, the disciple stay in the ashram, Guru goes out begging and gets money for them and then runs one institute here. He may have put it humorously, but you just imagine, one man going around the whole world, in spite of his health, collecting funds, raising people to organize, to build, to, you know, run the whole place, one man. What does he want out of it? Nothing. Why? Because he's already fulfilled. Gaining which nothing remains to be gained, towards that person, what will we do? So Kritagnataa even Kritagnataa, the disciple always feels so inadequate that for what the teacher has done to me, no matter what I do to that teacher, nothing will be sufficient. Because from emptiness he brought me to fulfillment. Nobody else can do that. Guruji always says, you know, Guruji means Swami Tejomayananda. He always says that, when you are hungry, somebody gives food, what do we feel? We feel happy and we thank that person, thank you so much. When we are thirsty, we drink, somebody gives water, we feel very happy. But here is somebody who has quenched the hunger and thirst of lives after lives after lives. What will we feel for that person? That bhav is called gratitude. The student then lives his whole life in the sense of gratitude, that my whole life is my worship of my own master, and no matter what I do, it will never be enough. So the person lives in humility. Imagine Gurudev saying this to this. He said this, that the whole mission is nothing but the grace of Tapon Maharaj, which is expressing. For him, the Chinmaya mission is the tapas and the grace of Tapon Maharaj. That's the bhav that a student has towards the teacher. So Kritagnataa is the moment by moment sadhana for a student to realize the truth. And having realized the truth also, Kritagnataa is moment by moment the expression of gratitude towards the teacher who has brought me to that state of fulfillment. No, Swamiji, but what fulfillment and all that, teacher and student in that state of Advaita, there is no duality, teacher and taught, all that disappears. That may happen in that state of Advaita, there is no doubt. But with the teacher, don't do Advaita. Very important line is, Guruna Saha Advaitam Na Kuryat. Teacher is teacher. world will still be seen. It's not that one doesn't see the world at all. One lives in that bhava of gratitude towards the teacher. Even if the master is realized, or even the student is realized, if two people who are realized also meet, the student is realized, master is realized. Will the student say, now I'm equal to you? No. The student will always feel grateful only, here you are the teacher who brought me to this state. So whether I am a sadhak, or whether I am a siddha, or whether I am neither of these two and I am still, my journey has to begin consciously. In all the three states, gratitude is most important. Even for worldly things to achieve, I must have gratitude. My mind will be better. Even as a spiritual seeker, I need gratitude. Even as a master, my whole life will then be an expression of gratitude. So this is the first verse, Samasta jana kalyane niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Satgurum Brahmavidvaram. So every time we chant this verse, the invocation, our purpose of chanting this invocation is to remember Gurudev. In this one verse, all aspects of his life beautifully summarized. So now we will go through these four quotations which are here. So each one first one here says, learn to have a vision, an ideal. Discover it in yourself. The true heroism is in living uncompromisingly to your ideal. That one individual who inspires the entire population, who defiantly stands firmly rooted in his own conviction, is the true hero inspiring generations. A visionary and a missionary is like that. One ideal. Uncompromisingly commit to that. Even in the world we find like that. No, somebody is committing oneself to one ideal, that person becomes, that maximum potential of that person manifests. So what is the ideal to which Dr. Kalam committed himself to? India. Okay. Anything else? India, education. To take India scientifically forward. So these are the ideals. What is the ideal that Nelson Mandela committed himself to? Equality, freedom, anti-apartheid, right? Different people commit themselves to different ideals. What was the ideal Gurudev committed himself to?
Awakening the mind.
See, spreading Vedanta is the means. Ideal is what? Result is maximum happiness to maximum people. What is the ideal? Two aspects. Hindu cultural revival. Nation building. And through that, realize the truth. We should never forget these two aspects. Hindu cultural revival. And that doesn't mean that only for Hindus he did. If you go to that place, the earth shelter, and you see one day in the life of Gurudev, in that there is a picture where he is sitting in a church. There is a cross behind, up there. There is a Om and there is a BMI chart. In the church, he is speaking. Because the knowledge of Vedanta is not limited only to Hindus. But Hindu cultural revival is very important. Consciously, see the ideal, that's why he says that discover it in you. Learn to have a vision and discover it in you. This is my ideal. And then commit oneself to that uncompromisingly. The speed of spiritual evolution depends on uncompromising commitment. If I compromise, that much slower I will be. If I want to evolve fast, uncompromising commitment. 2 years time, Narendra transformed into Vivekananda. 1884 he met his master. 1886 Ramakrishna Paramahamsa pastor. Just 2 years. How that happened? No compromise. Nisargadat Maharaj met his teacher only once. Few days the teacher stayed with him, did satsang. He had his provision stores, the Nisargadat Maharaj. He continued doing that work. But when his teacher went, the teacher only said once again, emphasizing to him, you are not this body. Refuse to believe that you are this body. That was his instruction. Over. He's doing all his work in the house, family. He didn't leave all that. But inside, no compromise from that thought. This body is one equipment. I am not this body. Over. He's living that way now. Realize the truth so fast. How did that happen? Not that some guru kept on blessing him and, you know, giving his grace and all that. The guru came once, told him what he had to tell, went away. Uncompromising commitment to spiritual knowledge, to an ideal. It can be any ideal. It need not be only a spiritual one. It can be the education of children. It could be empowering the youth. It could be removing poverty, literacy, anything. Uncompromising commitment. And the mission that he created. We should remember one aspect here. For whom did he create the mission? Did Gurudev want to do it by himself? Start an organization? No. He in fact said, I don't want to be institutionalized. Don't start any organization in my name. But the fact that that organization has got created is because there is a need of the hour. A missionary is one who will understand what is the need of the hour. Somebody doesn't have to tell that person. This is the need of the hour. We may say, okay, not everybody is capable of it. If somebody guides, at least it is easy. Fine. At least then have that spirit. Okay, this is the need of the hour. And a missionary is not only convinced by the need of the hour, is also able to bring about the means appropriate to those times to fulfill that need. And the third aspect of a missionary is very selfless. Doesn't want anything out of it. The cause is greater than individual. That is a missionary. When he says that, have the heroism to discover it in you, and one has to lose oneself in that cause. The individual becomes synonymous with the cause. And in the individual's mind, the cause alone remains, I doesn't remain. That is a missionary. This happens in every aspect. Somebody who is committed to music. What is the meaning that I am committed to music? Where I disappear into that music. Music just flows through me. Then that is my commitment to music. So in that way, a missionary finds out what is the need of the hour. Today, what is the need of the hour? There may be different fields, different need. There is no doubt. Right now, we are talking from the human being standpoint in general, because that's our field. Our field is not some external field. Our field is the individual. Stress, worry, tension, anxiety, depression, suicide, all that is on an increase. Discontentment, breakup of moral values, ethics, all that is happening or not. Technology goes on increasing. We have iPad and iPhone and iMac and so many things, technology-wise. Selfie we can keep taking, but we don't know who is the self. Tab we can have and keep on seeing things on the tab. But we don't know what is my true nature, what is my true purpose. That one is lost in that. So the mind needs inner strength, higher ideals, moral values. That is the need of the hour. The crisis is of the values. People can have value-based seminars, this, that, many things, but how many people are actually able to live those and they are aware of how to live those? Our schools don't teach. Moral science period is what period?
Free period.
Or some teacher has to come and finish her portion in that period. And now and then it will be PT period also. Yeah, play. Nobody taught. This whole generation then growing up. So the idea is that if I understand this is the need of the hour, the knowledge of Vedanta is to provide strength to the minds, to young people, to children, to adults, to everybody, corporate world. How much instability in the corporate world? How to handle all that? If the country has to revive, if the culture has to revive, if the whole world has to revive, one has to come back to that. A new world order doesn't come by destroying things. New world order doesn't come by just bringing some technological revolution. How much ever technological revolution may happen, it's a very strange thing that is happening nowadays. Human is becoming like machine. So much dependent on machines, so much lost in the machine, so much mechanicalness in one's life and approach. Mindfulness is gone, everything one is doing mechanically. So human being is becoming like a machine, and they are trying to make the machine like a human being. Introduce artificial intelligence, emotion in a robot. There are already robots who are doing a lot of work, you know. In India maybe it has not come, but abroad it has already come. A robot will come, clean things for you, do the dishes and then bring some food. You can program the robot, it will wake you up, it will be your companion. There is one small, this much robot it is. iBot or something it is called. It is a friend for your loneliness, for your child. Said, kamal hai. Chote chote bacche ke saath jaake khelne ke badle, now this fellow is going to play with one robot. The robot will always ask you, how are you today? How was your day today? You can talk to that robot and based on that it will respond to you. Some 30 responses will be there, so one of that it will choose and give. One can do all that entertainment, there is no problem. But inside the life is to be strong, na? It is becoming more hollow. So if I understand this is the need of the hour, he understood at that time. Just imagine, when we go to second verse, we will understand in what context, in what kind of situations he brought this knowledge to people. So if the mission is created, we have to understand one thing very important is, the mission is a sattvic environment to exhaust our rajoguna. He did not start it because he wanted name and fame. He started it because we as spiritual seekers need a field of service to purify our mind. And when we commit ourselves to seva, we purify our mind. We say, no, no, my life is very hectic, I don't have time for seva. It is like saying, my life is too hectic, I can't breathe. Sorry, no time to breathe. Breathing is inherent, body requires breathing. Same way, mind requires selflessness. Selfishness will destroy this mind. So how to be selfless? I can be selfless in my day-to-day life and work also. But there, somewhere the attachment comes in. So I don't know the joy of selflessness. When I identify with a cause purely for its own sake, where there is no I involved, no my people and my preferences, and you know, then I experience the joy of selflessness. So one field of service one should take up and commit to that. It can be the field of service for the youth, do some work for the youth, empower the lives of the youth, help in organizing events, help become an instructor, train the youngsters. So many things can be done. Or come up and do some administrative work, or serve in an ashram, do some work in a temple, wherever. Volunteer here at Pradeep. So many opportunities of seva are there. He created that field for us to exhaust our rajoguna. So in my service, if I am becoming quieter, over a period of time my service is making me feel more calm, more selfless. This whole ego pressure that what did I get, how much did I benefit, that goes away. That is the service, success of service. So Samasta jana kalyane niratam, that is the first aspect. Karunamayam is the compassionate aspect. A teacher operates out of compassion in every moment of his or her life. Even the anger of a teacher is only compassion. The The very fact that teacher comes down, shares the knowledge is compassion. They don't need to do it. Why will they want to do it? They got everything. So what is the quote that is here? I was born on that Shivratri day. The past of this body and mind has nothing to do with me. That is a sannyasi who drops the past. Meaning, this small I, this small ego, Balakrishna Menon, dropped. New name is given. New clothes are given. Why? That entire identity which is associated with that name is dropped. In that place a new person is born who is committed only to serve, to study and to meditate. So the past has nothing to do with me. That's why, actually speaking, traditionally speaking, you never ask a sannyasi about his or her past. What were you before? Have you learned? What have you studied? Were you married? If not married, why you didn't marry? Did you have a heartbreak? Have you gone through all the difficulties in life? So many questions people ask. One is curiosity, they want to know that how the person transformed, because then that inspires them, okay, I can do also. And that's a different matter. That's why the sannyasi also talk. But if you go to traditional places, you cannot ask a sannyasi. It's not appropriate to ask a sannyasi about the past, because that's over, dead. It's like asking about a dead body. A dead body kab paida hua tha? How many years old is this dead body? Did this dead body go through success? What business this dead body was doing? Will anybody ask? No. The person is dead, gone. So that's the meaning here, that he dropped the whole thing and in a place new person is born. So a sannyasi's attitude is compassion. One lives in that state. Compassion is different from pity. What is the difference?
There is no helplessness.
Pity is possible that one comes from an angle of superiority sometimes. In compassion, it is a sense of identification and oneness. I feel identified with that person. And I can reach out. I can help. Not because I am greater and somebody is lesser. So if somebody is compassionate and taking care of orphan children, the person identifies with the difficulty that the orphan children go through, and genuinely there is a feeling of goodness that I want to help and make this person come out of this state. It is not a superiority, I am capable, you are incapable, so I am doing. It's not like that. Or nor a pity saying, ki, arre, bichara, itna sa tadap raha, chalo kuch kar dete. Not out of that. One is moved by that suffering, but that suffering that brings out compassion in that person. That why should this person suffer? Let me extend myself. So in compassion, one gives oneself. That's the point. Because of identification, one gives oneself to that. It may be sometimes it may be time, sometimes it may be efforts, sometimes it may be resources also. Third aspect here is teacher. As a teacher, what did he do? As a teacher, I have given you all you need. Now it is for you to apply it in life, apply it all in life and learn to live, accepting everything, rejecting nothing, reflecting all, yet keep nothing. Only a spiritual teacher can say, as a teacher, I have given you all you need. No other teacher can say this statement. Every other teacher can only give one part of our life to us, one part of what we need. Economics teacher can give only knowledge of economics. That is only one small part of my life. Physics teacher only that. Maths teacher only that. Only a spiritual teacher can say, I have given you all you need. Why? because I've given you self-knowledge, gaining which everything is known. It's like telling that if you know the water, then you know all the waves in the ocean. Then I don't have to introduce to you Pacific Ocean and Indian Ocean and Atlantic Ocean and all that. I've given you knowledge of water, now you see everywhere. Water alone is. So I've given you all you need. And what does it take to give all you need? See, the teacher's job is most unenviable. Because the students who are willing to learn, no, are very few. In general only. Forget Brahma Vidya. In general itself, how many children want to learn? You just imagine your life as a student. How difficult for the teacher. Because we are interested in masti. And teacher is interested in disciplining and giving knowledge. At that time, we don't know why this knowledge is required. So we somehow go through that. Every teacher has to go through difficult time. Very few will be studious students. And the word for them is nerd. They will be called as nerd, bookworm, all that. Majority will want to go to school just because the parent wants to get rid of me, so I'm going to school. Teacher wants to get rid of me, so I'm going to house. Like a football, I'm in toss. Only place where I feel belonged is my friends with whom I play. And that friend nowadays is a robot. But you just imagine spiritual knowledge. Do we even know we are bound? Teacher comes and tells us, "Arey Baba, you are bound." He says, "What bound? You are bound. You are a fool. You are not living life properly. Live life with enthusiasm. What you are living in self-control? Look at my life." So many people say that. Self-control. Why are you living in self? Why have you restricted yourself so much? Be free. That compassion of the teacher listens to all that. Okay, okay, beta, one day you will realize what you are talking. Till then I wait. How many people would have argued with Gurudev, told so many things to him. Even fired him, why are you even coming and disturbing? If you read, no, there's one beautiful letter in a book called Vedantra Through Letters, Part 1. Right now that's out of print. But in that there's one question that person has asked. Why have you come down? Why did you not stay in the Himalayas and be in that Vasishta Guha? Why did you people come down and why are you teaching this to all of us? He asked that question. Gurudev said, "I am very happy you are asking this question. If you were capable of realizing the truth, people like us wouldn't need to come down." And the example he gives there is, the stones in the Vasishta Guha have had the presence of Vasishta Maharshi and have been there for many, many years together. Nothing happened to them. So his point there was that even the presence of that master did not influence things around. Meaning when mind is inert, when mind is not open enough, sitting there in your house, even if the master is spreading knowledge from the Himalayas, one will not be able to understand. He communicated that in a very effective way. He's saying, "I can sit from the mountain and communicate, but your radio set has to be tuned. If you don't tune it up, it will not come to you. To tune your radio set, I have to come, because you can't do it by yourself." Like that he explained it. So teacher's job is very tough, because the student will go on resisting, because the ego is like that, goes on resisting. Whatever the teacher says, I will not do. Slowly, slowly, slowly one understands. And lots of patience, maximum patience is required in spiritual path by the spiritual teacher. Even in other knowledge, patience is required by teacher, but spiritual knowledge, because evolution is very slow. You can expect that evolution will happen very fast. That's a false expectation. So as a teacher, that's why he says, I have given you all you need. And that's the detachment of the teacher also. Okay, I have done my best. Now it is up to you. You have to live it. Imagine 3 hours the knowledge of the Gita is given by Krishna. 3 hours in the sense, it takes 3 hours for us to chant that Gita. When the whole knowledge of the Gita is given, did Bhagavan tell Arjun, now this much mehnat I have done, you better fight the war. Say, yatha ichasi tatha kur. I have done what I needed to do. You do what is your choice now. That's the detachment of a teacher. I have given you what all that you need. Now it is up to you to live. That's how he lived whole life as a teacher. Then realized master. See, this is one beauty of Gurudev. He never projected himself as a realized master. But he dedicated all his work to this Shruti. So what does he say here? Someone read that.
Is dedicated to the Shruti's scriptures that told me what the reality is. Swami Tapavanji Maharaj of Uttarkashi who guided me to the end and pushed me into the beyond, and the Satgurudev Swami Shivanand Maharaj of Rishikesh who showed me in his life how to live and act in God as God.
Right. So, what the scriptures told and how Tapon Maharaj pushed him into the beyond. The credit goes to both these masters. He gives to the Shrutis, he gives to the masters, Shivananji Maharaj and Taponji Maharaj. State of realization is the most exalted state. And a truly realized master never projects that I am realized, because there is no I to project. One will never say that I am realized master, now you all come to me. That is most delusory. Because realization is what? Brahman in me is Brahman everywhere. Self in me is the self everywhere. That's the state of realization. There is no duality. There is only one supreme consciousness, with all of these are expressions of that state. So the whole ego functions in that exclusivity. I am separate. I am great. I am Brahman. You are jivas, ignorant, bound. That is delusion. Realization, that is false realization. Realization truly is Chidananda Rupa, Shivoham, Shivoham. And that Chidananda Rupa is the nature of all people. So, when he says this, Gurudev as a realized master, he never projected himself as a realized master, but he operated out of that state of realization, out of that state of fulfillment. Nothing ever makes him feel inadequate. Fearlessly he lived, unconditionally he loved, tirelessly he served, compassionately, unconditionally compassionate. That is the state of realization. And last one is Namami Chinmayam Devam. So Gurudev as a master was very, very unique. Very rare it is to find a master like him. Not only as a spiritual master, but even as a leader, just as an organization, if you look at him as a leader also, how much is there to learn from him in terms of a leadership qualities? How did he run such a massive organization? Where there are no, it is not that it's like a corporate world where there is, you know, systems, hierarchies, processes, everything. It is there in some areas, it is there, but it's all voluntary now. So much is voluntary. Funds are voluntary, people are voluntary, time they are committing is voluntary, and then how is the whole organization running, how is the discipline, how people are tuned up to the vision, all that. So him as a leader, him as a missionary person, him as an individual who lived, living those spiritual values, and how he exhibited specially his letter writing, all that you will see. Can you imagine getting up in the morning at 42 years, at 3 or 3:30 in the morning, every day? Come what may. If you and I have a little migraine, what we will do? Ek ghanta aur so jaate. His heart is functioning how much? 16%. does he say that today I deserve more rest? No. Tirelessly working. Special quality of his. And his letters you should see. He doesn't bunch up his letters. Read all the letters and bunch it up saying, okay, this is children's letters, this is adults' letters, this is brahmachari's letters, this is professional's letter. Now that I have segregated them, first I'll finish answering all children. Then I will finish answering all grahasthis. Then all the professionals. Nothing. One letter will be to a child and he will tune his mind to the child and write in such a way, child-friendly language. Next letter will be from a grahasthi. Third letter will be from a brahmachari. Fourth will be from a housewife. Fifth one will be from a professional. How much the clarity is and how much one goes on shifting. You see in that earth shelter, you will see different types of letters that he has written. That's very unique to him. His artistic nature. All those we will see as we go along. So for right now, we will stop here. First verse is what we have done. We will have a short juice break. And the next session will be a group discussion session.